Hi, it's Kiffin Lobates here, and today I thought I would make a short video on the Akutars smart contract fiasco, which has ended up with about $34 million, 11,000 ETH, of value locked in the contract that can never be retrieved. And there are plenty of articles out there that dig into the exact mechanics of what happened to lock up these funds. So I thought it would be more interesting to look at a higher level what was going on. And I went through the code for about 15 or 20 minutes on Sunday just to have a look at what was going on. And there are a few things that struck me. The first thing is that the programmer who produced the code is clearly competent, well, actually not competent, but fluent in programming. You can see this, for example, by the fact that the code is littered with ternary conditionals. Junior programmers tend to have a problem with understanding these for some reason. And the code looks pretty tight, but there's one thing that immediately struck me, which is that there are no comments. There are lines that are altering the values of variables and doing stuff, and yet there's no comment explaining what the aim of the particular line of code is. And that's a first red flag. You should use comments to explain the purpose of what you're doing in various lines of code, especially in Solidity, because the code tends to be fairly short. So adding a few comments here and there is not going to increase the screen falls dramatically. And the meaning in Solidity, the smart contract programming language for Ethereum, can kind of pack a lot of different meaning into very, very short statements. So that's kind of the first red flag. The second red flag is that the contract extensively uses state variables and counters. So a state variable is where you use a value to keep track of changes in things that are happening over time. And there are, I think, at least three that are used extensively in this smart contract. And one of them involves time, which is always a bit of a red flag again in Ethereum contracts, because when you have things that are dependent on how far along the Ethereum blockchain has moved over time, you end up with risks, and it's really quite tricky to test all the boundary cases. So that's a whole bunch of red flags. Then the final thing is that the two particular functions that are causing problems, the process refunds and the emergency withdrawal, are full of revert statements. Now, a revert statement is where the code checks whether a condition is true or false, and then either continues executing your transaction or just completely bails out as if you never submitted the transaction in the first place, and then you lose the gas that was burnt to execute up to that point, but it rewinds the state so that you end up as if the transaction had never been sent in the first place. And revert statements in emergency withdrawal contracts, functions rather, are another red flag. You should be checking that the right person is allowed to execute the emergency withdrawal. But if you put a whole bunch of other conditions that have to be true in there and something goes wrong, as it did in the Akutars contract, then your emergency parachute, as it were, no longer has a ripcord. Or rather, the ripcord is so difficult to pull that no one can ever feasibly do it in the time it takes you to plummet to Earth and crash. So these are the kind of things, when I look at the contract, that I start worrying about. The engineering of the contract is so complicated that you can't just look at it and say, right, I grasp what's going on here. It takes quite a bit of digging to understand what all these different counters are keeping track of. And then you have to dig deeper to work out why there are these statements that tell transactions to bail if one counter is less than another counter or more than another counter or so on and so forth. And that means it's very hard for anybody to have a full overview in their head of what the contract is meant to be doing. Then when you add on top of that the problem of boundary cases, conditions where numbers end up not being what you expect them to be, and therefore your revert statements kick in unexpected circumstances, well, that's exactly what happened in this contract. Through a number of different odd transactions by people who were trying to flag the fact that this contract was full of risk, the state variables got into a state that the developer did not expect. And as a result, their revert statements cause the process refunds and the emergency withdrawals functions to bail out before they get to the point that they start paying out. And if you've got payment conditions that can never be met, then the funds are locked in the contract and you can't retrieve them. And this is exactly what happened. So really, things like testing can pick up these things, but there's a step earlier that needed to be taken, namely thinking about the architecture of the contract. Why is it so complicated? Why are there so many different state variables? And thinking about the conditions under which you want that complicated architecture to proceed or not proceed. And because it's so complicated, you can't keep it all in your head. Therefore, you can't properly think of all sorts of different boundary conditions that might occur and test for them. And that, I think, is fundamentally the reason behind the failure of the Akutar contract. And I've seen this in standard development, where developers produce an over-engineered solution, and as a result, as a test engineer, it's trivial to find lots and lots of different cases where it falls over. Unfortunately for Akutar, they're not just dealing with a piece of software that can be upgraded and updated on a phone or fixed in a web server or something like that. They're dealing with a contract that is immutable because it's been sent to a blockchain and it's locked down. And as a result, $34 million is locked down too and will never be seen again. That's it for today. I hope that helped you understand a bit about the sort of psychology and mentality behind smart contracts and the way of thinking you need to have. And I'll see you all in the next video soon. Bye for now.